Yeah. Look around the room. I can tell that you are the most beautiful girl in the room. In the whole wide room.
Okay, in this series of videos, we're going to take a look at bonds and bond valuation. So let's get started and take a look at bond characteristics. In the simplest possible terms, a bond is simply a long-term loan, and it can be a loan to a variety of different institutions. We can have loans to companies, so a corporate bond. That can either be a domestic company based here in the U.S. or it can be a foreign company, where we might have a foreign bond or a euro bond. It is a bond denominated in a currency other than the home currency of the borrower. The borrower could also be a municipality, so it might be a municipal bond to a state government, to a local government. The distinction with municipal bonds being that they're tax-free in the state that they're issued. Tax-free both in terms of state taxes and federal taxes. And then also a long-term loan to government. So it could be the U.S. government. We call those treasuries. So treasury notes would be loans to the U.S. government that have 1 to 10 years of maturity. Treasury bonds, the distinction there is it has longer time to maturity, so 10 to 30 years. And also foreign governments borrow money. So the Japanese government, the Greek government, the German government all issue bonds. And investors can buy those as well. So bonds are just loans to different institutions. And then a few things about bonds themselves. The first thing we need to consider is the par value or face value of the bond. This is simply how much the borrower promises to pay back at maturity. Note that it may or may not be equal to the amount that's borrowed initially. So for instance, with the case of zero coupon bonds, the borrower may promise to pay back $1,000 per bond, but may initially only receive a fraction of that amount up front. So they're borrowing maybe $100, $200 up front, and then 10 years, 15 years down the line, they're going to pay back $1,000. The coupon interest rate is another important term we need to get our hands around, and that's just an interest rate that's used to determine the coupon payment on the bond. Most bonds pay interest twice a year. They're semi-annual bonds, semi-annual coupons, although that could be monthly, could be quarterly, could be any period, but typically bonds pay interest semi-annually. Then there's also, as I just mentioned, zero coupon bonds. They're issued at a discount, always issued at a discount. There are no interest payments during the life of the bond, and so the coupon is zero. The maturity date of the bond is an important component of the bond. That simply states when the bond has to be repaid, when the investor should get that par value back. The price of a bond, how much is paid up front for the bond. Again, that may or may not be equal to how much the borrower is borrowing. If bonds are sold at a premium, if they're issued at a premium, the borrower may get more in proceeds than the face value. That's not typically what happens. Typically, companies, when they issue bonds, they issue them at face value, at par value. So they sell them for $1,000, and then they pay back $1,000 at maturity. The yield to maturity, another important term, shows how much the bond will earn as a percentage rate if it is held to maturity. And there's a little caveat here that assumes that the investor is able to reinvest the interest payments at the interest rate, the yield to maturity interest rate. And so the yield to maturity, this is what most people think about when they talk about the interest rate for a bond. So bonds are simply a time value problem applied to real life. So as with all time value calculations, there are 5 possible inputs. If we know 4 of them, then we can figure out what the 5th one is. And those 5 possible inputs are going to be the par value or face value of the bond. That's going to be equal to the future value of the bond. So it's going to be the FV input. The coupon rate of the bond determines the payment. So it's going to give us the amount of the constant payments that the bond makes in terms of interest payments. And so the input for our calculations is going to be equal to the coupon rate times the face value of the bond, and then we're going to divide that by the number of periods or the number of payments per year that the bond makes. So for instance, if a coupon rate is 4.5%, With a typical bond, and I should step back here and say, a typical bond, it has a $1,000 face value, and it pays coupons semi-annually. So in the absence of any other information, you should assume that's the kind of bond we're talking about. So if the coupon rate on a typical bond is 4.5%, the payment input would be 4.5% of 1,000, so that's $45. We're going to divide that by 2, and so the input for the payment would be $22.50 per period. The maturity determines the number of periods, so that's the N input. If the bond pays interest semi-annually, then N is simply going to be the number of years times 2, which would be the number of six-month periods until maturity. If the bond happens to pay interest quarterly, then N would just be 4 times the number of years until maturity. So it's going to indicate how many quarters are left. The price of a bond is simply the present value. It's typically going to have a negative sign in front of it to indicate that in purchasing a bond, you're making an outflow. In typical inputs for calculators and for Excel, you need to indicate this cash flow with a negative sign, or else you'll get errors in your calculations. And then finally, the yield to maturity is going to be equal to the I input, the periodic interest rate. We would need to adjust this input based on the length of the periods. So the default period of time for inputs on calculators and for Excel is annual. And so we would need to adjust that if the coupon payments are not annual. So a semi-annual bond, for instance, we need to have the yield to maturity divided by 2 to be the input for the calculations. Let's look at some more bond features here. Bonds may have a call feature. And that gives the issuing entity the right to redeem or pay off the bonds early. So a bond may have a maturity 20 years from now, but if it has a call feature, if it's a callable bond, then the issuer may choose to redeem the bond or choose to pay off the bond early. There's typically, with callable bonds, a window of call protection. So for instance, for the first 5 years, the bond may not be called. There's typically a call premium. So the call price is going to be higher than the face value. For some bonds, that might be a sliding scale. The longer the bond is held, the longer the bond is outstanding, or the closer it gets to maturity, that call premium might start to diminish. But typically, bonds will have a call premium. So for instance, if it's called after 5 years, you might receive $1,050 for every bond instead of the $1,000 face value. And an important point here, because of the additional risk for the borrower, that is that the bond may be called away, that they may not get the interest payments that they were kind of counting on, callable bonds have a higher yield to maturity. They pay a higher interest rate than comparable non-callable bonds. So if we have two bonds, everything about them is the same, except one is callable, one is non-callable. The callable bond will have a higher interest rate. It'll pay a higher yield to the investor. There's also put feature that can be a part of a bond. This is far less common, but in this case, a put feature would give the bondholder the option of extending the bond's life. Instead of it being the option of the borrower, the issuer, it's now the option of the bondholder. Do I want to keep these funds outstanding? Do I want to extend the loan to this company, or do I want to call it a day and get my money back? Sinking fund is a part of many bonds, and that's where firms will set aside money to pay off the bonds over time. It might work where a company redeems a certain portion of the outstanding bonds each year. That'd probably be the typical setup. It would be kind of a randomized kind of thing where maybe if you have a 20-year life of the bond, and as part of the bond covenants, as part of the documents related to this bond, the contract surrounding the bond, it may be such that the issuing company has to buy back 1/20th of the bonds or pay off 1/20th of the bonds each year. And so that would be a sinking fund. It's a mechanism to help ensure the safety of the lender's capital. Convertible bonds are also a type of bond out there, and this is where the owners of the bond, and these would be the people that are lending money to companies, where they have the right or the option to convert bonds into a certain number of shares in the company. So convertible bonds start out as debt, but if the circumstances of the stock turn out to be favorable for the lender, they may convert that debt to equity and enjoy a big gain, enjoy upside from sharing in the company's good fortunes. And then floating rate bonds, another type of bond. These are bonds where the coupon rate changes based on market conditions. It'll adjust up or down based on an underlying index and what happens to that. So for instance, if we had bonds that were tied to the one-year constant treasury rate, as that one-year treasury rate bounces up and down based on market conditions, the coupon rate for those bonds would adjust. So we're gonna stop right now for this first video. We'll pick up with some alternative bond types in the next video, and we'll see you there.